Imagine you need to buy a new laptop. You go into a shop, and the model you had your eyes on is rather expensive. So you go to another shop, which asks for the same price. Then you do an online search and realize all retailers ask for the exact same price for that laptop. Can that really be a coincidence? Sometimes it is, but when it's not, the reason might be an illegal cartel agreement. Luckily, there are exciting new ways to safeguard competition using digital technology. This is one of my areas of research here at WU. My name is Viktoria Robertson, and I am a professor of competition law and digitalization at the Department of Private Law. In my research, I look into how competition law enforcement can harness the power of technology to uncover anti-competitive activity. This area is called computational antitrust. What we do is we translate legal requirements into software or algorithms. Then we test the capabilities of these tools to uncover anti-competitive behavior, but also their shortcomings and blind spots. And we assess how they fit into the current legal framework. This type of research requires legal expertise, as well as expertise in business, data analytics, and programming. Competition authorities are constantly on the lookout for signs of price fixing and other anti-competitive activity. In the past, one of their most effective tools was the so-called leniency program. When a company approached a competition authority and helped them uncover a cartel, they were given immunity from hefty fines. But worldwide, these leniency applications have been in decline. It seems that cartelists have gotten better at hiding their anti-competitive activity. And that's why competition authorities have to up their game. In my research with Jürgen Fleiß, Jan Amthauer and Franziska Guggi, we ask how competition authorities can use computational tools to support them in their investigations. To do this, we carried out a case study using publicly accessible data from Austria. Most cases in Austria focus on resale price maintenance, so we decided to go for this type of anti-competitive agreement. Resale price maintenance, or RPM, is when a manufacturer demands that resellers price their product at the recommended resale price. Otherwise, it will no longer deliver this product to them. So the recommended price isn't actually recommended at all, but rather required. This is bad for consumers because the price is not determined by demand, but by the manufacturer's decision. And it's illegal as well. For our study, we zoomed in on something everyone needs to buy once in a while: washing machines. We looked at different models sold in Austria and checked whether we could detect resale price maintenance. For the pricing data, we relied on web scraping from a popular price comparison site and made a database that now contains over 1 million price data points. With this data, we built two dashboards. The first shows the prices of a certain model of washing machine over time and lets you compare it to other models. The second dashboard shows a metric called the coefficient of variation. Essentially, it shows whether different prices are offered for the same washing machine model. A low coefficient of variation means that prices for that model are rather uniform, perhaps indicating resale price maintenance. A high coefficient of variation means that prices for that model are not uniform, perhaps indicating that prices are individually set by resellers that compete with each other, as it should be. Our results show that there was one washing machine manufacturer in particular where all retailers had a uniform price and where the coefficient of variation was extremely low. This could be an indication of RPM and a reason for competition authorities to take a closer look, for example through a Dawn raid. We are now applying our framework to other products, like fridges and dishwashers, and also applying machine learning to make the process easier to handle for competition authorities and consumer organizations. The data we used for our case study was publicly accessible, but it was not available in a structured format. This made our data collection very labor-intensive. If we want competition authorities to use computational antitrust screens in their day-to-day enforcement, they must have easy access to relevant, structured, and up-to-date business data. There's another question we have to address. What is the legal quality that evidence from computational antitrust provides? Or in other words, can we use this to prove an infringement of competition law in court? Here, we need to take into account the bias in certain data sets and also alternative explanations for the patterns we observe. For example, retailers may all charge the same prices because they are competing fiercely and would otherwise not be able to make any profit. And they might increase prices at the exact same time because electricity prices went up. So this is something we need to consider. That said, there's probably no way around using these digital tools in the future. Because even if we don't, we can be sure that some companies will use technology to mask their price fixing. It looks like we're at the beginning of an arms race between competition authorities and cartelists. And the computational antitrust tools we develop highlight exciting new options to get ahead in this race.